Before we get into the next part of some of those qualities of the beauty of the woman, I want to share with you something that happened to me when I was on a trip in Europe. I was in ministry in Europe this summer, in Poland and in France and in the UK. And unknown to me, having no idea that the subject that the Lord was going to give me to teach at this retreat was gardens, I was being taken to gardens all over Europe. I mean, and European gardens are gorgeous. Yesterday I told you, Solomon's Palace, they had a private garden. And if you go to European palaces, they all have beautiful grounds. They're often surrounded by land and agriculture, just as we said yesterday. But then they have these enclosed gardens, which are just for the king and his company. And I ended up in Poland going to some of the palaces there. Absolutely beautiful gardens, gorgeous, roses in abundance. And then I went to France, and I had one day to myself, and I woke up one morning and I thought, I'm just going to go for a walk. I was in Rennes, which is in the county of Brittany, and it was beautiful, the city was beautiful, but I stumbled upon this building that looked like a palace, small palace, but it was gorgeous, the grounds were beautiful, and so I just kind of was drawn to it, and because I was looking for peace and quiet, I wanted somewhere to go and have my quiet time. And so I had my journal, my Bible with me, and I walk through this courtyard, there's a gate you're going to see, and I come into a gorgeous garden, quite a large garden, almost like a park. And I just thought, wow, this is so gorgeous. And so I sat there for maybe 10, 15, 20 minutes contemplating, walked around, took some video, took some photographs. Really just for me, because it was so beautiful. And then I got up and something just drew me to walk more. And as I kept walking, I found this entryway into another garden. And I think that's the garden that the Lord is talking about when he says, my love is a garden of roses. And there were so many flowers and trees, and the peace was beautiful. There was nobody there but me. And it was just gorgeous. Well, I was taking photographs in abundance. Like, I couldn't take enough, you know. I didn't know what I was going to do with them, but I just loved the flowers in this garden, the roses and the beauty of it. And the peace was what drew me. It was the peace of the garden. It was so quiet. It was still. And I just kept thinking, I don't know why I'm so drawn to gardens just now. What is it about the garden? Well, then the Lord started talking to me about the garden of our hearts. And I was drawn to the song, some of you may remember this, and I've put a copy of it at the back of your folders. And by the way, when I read to you this morning, your bridegroom is overwhelmed with your beauty. That is written in there. I wrote that a few years ago when I got that text. So it's in there. If you haven't already found it, there are no pages afterwards to write notes. I'm sorry, I keep forgetting to refer you there. But if you go right to the back of your book, you should have a piece of paper that says, in the garden, with the pretty borders around it, if you haven't read it already. And behind it, the song called In the Garden. And some of you will remember this from way back. And it's such a beautiful song of intimacy about coming into the garden alone with Jesus. Some versions of that song, like Elvis Presley and some others I've heard, I was sharing with some of the girls, I was trying to find a version that would be suitable to play here. Because some of it's got these dramatic piano entries, that these old church music, and you're like, oh my gosh. Everyone is just going to be hysterical and won't take it serious, you know, people running up and down the piano, heavy music. And that, to me, isn't what this song's about at all. It's peaceful, it's compelling. But it's even more compelling when you know the story behind it. And the story behind it is that it was written by this hymn writer, Austin Miles, who says that one day in April, and I put this in your book, 1912, I was seated in the dark room where I kept my photographic equipment and organ. I drew my Bible toward me. It opened at my old favorite chapter, John 20. Whether by chance or inspiration, let the reader decide. That meeting of Jesus and Mary had lost none of its power and charm. As I read it that day, I seemed to be part of the scene. I became a silent witness to that dramatic moment in Mary's life when she knelt before her Lord and cried, Rabboni. My hands were resting on the Bible while I stared at the blue wall. As the light faded, I seemed to be standing at the entrance of a garden, looking down a gently winding path, shaded by olive branches. A woman in white, with head bowed, hand clasping her throat as if to choke back her sobs, walked slowly into the shadows. It was Mary. As she came to the tomb, upon which she placed her hand, she bent over to look in, and then she hurried away. John, in flowing robe, appeared, looking at the tomb. Then came Peter, who entered the tomb, followed slowly by John. As they departed, Mary reappeared. Leaning her head upon her arm at the tomb, she wept. Turning herself, she saw Jesus standing, and so did I. I knew it was he. She knelt before him with arms outstretched. She looked into his face and cried, "Rabboni." I awakened in sunlight, gripping the Bible with muscles tense and nerves vibrating. Under the inspiration of this vision, I quickly wrote as the words could be formed. The poem exactly as it has appeared since. That same evening, I wrote the music. Why was Mary so desperate at the tomb to see Jesus? I don't know what was going on in her heart. She was one of the first ones to go there, even when she thought was in the grave. She went to weep at the grave, to worship him even in his death, while the disciples, in fear and terror and much anguish and sorrow, were back somewhere in the city, in hiding, angry, I would suggest. But Mary was worshiping. It says the disciples were in deep anguish, which translates into it was an angry sorrow. Like, where had their vision gone? What was happening? And probably scared about what was going to happen next to them. But Mary and the other women are at the tomb, worshipping Jesus even in his death. And they were rewarded for that. Because she got to see him. She got the first glimpse. She was a woman who he had delivered from 7 demons. That's why she was seeking him at the tomb. He changed her life. When Jesus comes in and changes your life, and I'm talking about you can be saved and still not have experienced the deliverance that God wants to give you. You can still be bound in shame and fear and self-righteousness. But when you get a deliverance from Jesus, when you meet him like Paul did on the Damascus Road, when you encounter Jesus, things change. It's powerful. Paul knew truth for years. He knew every single word of the Torah and everything that was in it. But he had to meet Jesus for it to make the difference. You can know the Bible, you can know head knowledge, but you need Jesus to bring transformation. That's what Geneva was talking about this morning. We need spirit and truth. We need the revelation of Jesus in the spirit. We're here today to talk about revelation, talk about transformation. You know, I'm teaching these things on Song of Song, and I don't want to go into a whole lot of the technical teaching of it, because you're not stupid people. You're all intelligent women, and these days everybody has a phone, and you can do so much research. You can come up with 100 different translations. You can do the history of the Bible. You can check up if what I'm telling you is correct. You can spout knowledge to other people. You can make out like you know your Bible, because any one of us can know our Bibles. If we really get into the internet, you can get on and know your Bible. But do you know Jesus? Do you know him intimately? Has he delivered you from things that nobody else could have delivered you from? Oh my goodness, when you have that moment, you're never the same. And it's usually in pain, it's in the death, it's in that terrible place. Whatever you're going through right now, some of you have lost loved ones. Some of you have had terrible things happen recently. Oh, I want to encourage you this hope. We're going to talk about that tonight. What's the hope when you're going through pain? What do you cling to in your struggle? Winston Churchill came to speak at a conference of young first-year entry at university in the UK. I think it was at Oxford. And the dean of the college had prepared these men, you know, bring your journals, you know, like you're doing. Bring your journals. Make sure you get lots of notes from this great orator that's led us through the World War. And he stood up on the podium, Winston Churchill, and he said, never, never never, never give up. And he closed his book and he went home. That was it. Because that's what he kept saying through the war. Never, 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 never give up. Never give in to the enemy. Never give up on hope. Because God is the God of all hope and comfort. And he's going to use whatever you're going through to bring out a sweet-smelling fragrance. And the fragrance will not come out unless he takes you through these paths of suffering. Because how can we share in the suffering of others if we've never suffered ourselves? You cannot identify with a woman in pain if you don't know what pain is like. That's why I said, I can identify with anybody in this room because I've been through so much pain. I don't know what your pain has been. I don't know what the circumstance was, but I know pain in the heart. I can weep with you. I can listen to you. I can understand what you're going through. And that was the training ground. But I also get to see the revelations of Jesus. Because I seek him now more than I did before. I get encounters at the tomb where I'm in the death place. He reveals himself to me. He gave me that vision I shared with you last night. And he's given others that just reveal himself to me that I would have never had before when I thought I had my act together and I was busy doing ministry. For goodness sake, don't get busy doing ministry for the sake of doing ministry. Of course do ministry. God calls us to ministry. But seek more than that. Don't do it for the sake of doing it and because of guilt and shame. Get the right order. Jesus says, come follow me. Go where he is. Don't bring him to where you are. Follow him. And sometimes that means I want you to follow me into the garden. I want you to follow me into the cross. I want you to follow me to the tomb. I want you to follow me to a place that you would never have thought of going. I want you to give up your title and follow me. Just follow me, love me, and trust me. And you'll have more ministry than you've ever imagined. And maybe not many people will know about it. But he'll know. And you will be so fulfilled. Here's Mary. She meets Jesus at the tomb, and she goes and she tells the disciples, and they basically don't want to know. And Jesus himself had to come and rebuke them, which there's a lesson for us women. That you're trying to tell your husband, I have this encounter with Jesus and you've got to change. You've got to believe he's real and he really does great powerful things. You know, he's going like, whatever. You know, you have this great meeting down there in Lake Buena Vista and you go home all shouting with joy and excited about what Jesus has done in your life. And they're like, I'm really glad you had a great time, honey. Yeah, but I want you to know as well. And he's not getting it because even when Mary told the disciples, it's like when Mary, the mother of Jesus, was pregnant, Joseph didn't believe it. Jesus had to come and appear to Joseph, and he had to appear to the disciples himself, and he rebuked them for their hard-heartedness. So there's hope, ladies. Let Jesus do it. He can speak to them. He spoke to Adam. He spoke to the disciples. He spoke to the prophets. He can speak to men. And he does. He does. Trust him for that. We don't need to deal with that. We just need to get with Jesus. So I want to give you a moment to share my experience in France in the garden. Before we go back in, we're going to pray that this is going to work, right? We're going to try. Otherwise, I'll be singing the song in the garden and not really be pretty.
On my ear, the sun.
joining here was this one that I found in the garden. All the roses were named. The one had the name Adam. I don't know if you just saw that. Let's see if I can come back to that somewhere. But that last one there, Adam. And then this one. Isn't that beautiful?
Yeah.
Gorgeous. And this one here. Even if you don't speak French, we know what parfum is, right?
Yeah.
Royal perfume. Royal perfume is what we find in the garden. That's what Jesus sees in the garden of your heart. He sees the royal perfume. And we only get that perfume when we spend time with him in that garden. We become the fragrance of the people we hang out with. And that's why I said before, and don't just do ministry for the sake of ministry. The Lord wants us to serve in the ministry. But if I don't get this time in the garden with him, I'm going to serve him out of my own strength. And these features that we're talking about in Songs chapter 4, they won't develop in me because I'm going to be doing it in my flesh. And it's hard to see Jesus when I'm operating in my flesh, when I'm in control. One of the next features that we come on to here in Song of Solomon 4, we talked about the eyes, we talked about the hair. We talked about the teeth, being able to chew on the word. The lips, I believe, come out of spending time with Jesus. The lips indicate what's in our hearts. In Matthew 12 and 16, actually, and Luke chapter 6, if you wanted to make that reference, in fact, we can go there. We should go there. Let's just go to Matthew. Let's go Matthew first. Matthew 12. Matthew 12. Jesus said that a tree will be known by its fruit. Either make the tree good and its fruit good, or else make the tree bad and its fruit bad, for a tree is known by its fruit. Brood of vipers, he's talking to the Pharisees. How can you, being evil, speak good things? Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth evil things. But I say to you, every idle word men speak, they will give account of in the day of judgment. For by your words you'll be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. We have to speak words of life and faith.
Yes.
The Bible says that the tongue has power to bring life or death, blessing or cursing. And in Deuteronomy, he says, choose. Choose which you will do this day, life or death, blessing or cursing. You have to make a choice. Am I going to speak negative things over my life, over my family, over my circumstance? Or am I going to speak words of faith? Because God created the whole world by the words of his mouth. Through his lips, he created you. He created me, he created the world. Every living thing was through the word of God. So when I take the word of God and I speak the word of God over somebody, I'm speaking life over them. The word of God has power. It has life because it's living. It's a living two-edged sword, dividing even to the spirit and the soul. It divides out what is in my flesh that's not of God and brings out the spirit which is of God. But it has to be in my heart. And that's why I need time with Jesus to absorb his word and let his word transform me, not just give me information. It's about being transformed by the word of God so that those words will come out of my mouth, because his nature will come out of my word, and my lips will have sweet words for others because they lift up Jesus and they bring life. That's what Jesus did, and we are born of Adam, the second Adam. We're his bride, and he brought words of grace everywhere he went. And sometimes I think, Lord Jesus, I don't spend enough time with you because sometimes my words are not very gracious. It depends how much pressure you put on me. I can be really gracious when I've just come out of the garden, but within seconds, something's there, right? To irritate you, push the button. Just depends which button you push. Usually it's the technology button. often, my computer at work, or just before a stressful event, and you're supposed to get up there and stand and be the fragrance of Jesus, and Satan's doing everything he can to bring those worst words out of your mouth, because then he wants me to go into guilt. When how can you stand up in front of a room full of women and talk like that and look at what you just did or said, right? How many of us struggle with that? Oh, we're up there teaching or speaking or sharing the gospel or being nice to our neighbors and trying to be the fragrance of Jesus in our community, or an example to my children, and you just blown it again. And the enemy comes in with those prowling voices just like Michael felt, and he's going, oh, look at you, you are so useless, there is no way, you're such a hypocrite, you cannot get up there and speak. You know what you do? You get on your knees before the cross and say, you're absolutely right. I am a stinking rotten sinner, and I know that, but God's given me a new creation, and I am in Him. And that's why I get up here and speak. Not to say I'm better than any of you. I'm the worst of all sinners. God alone knows that. I have no right to talk about anything about Liz Dickson except to say I'm a new creation. Hallelujah. And I know I'm in His bride. And I want to talk about Him. I've spoken for 2 weeks, Lord, and said, don't let this be about me. Don't let it be about me. Even as we share our testimonies, don't let it be about us. Let it be about Him.
Amen.
He's the bridegroom. Let's not do what the world does and make much of the bride. Let's make much of the bridegroom. Oh, God, He's taken me as a pauper. He took me out of a miry pit. I keep telling you that, but He did. And He dressed me in robes of righteousness and a garment of salvation, and I can never take them off. I go to bed with them and I wake up with them. Hallelujah, they're still there. And I feel like Christ. I might not have slept last night. My neighbors keep me awake night after night, and I'm so bad-tempered and irritable with them. I want to bang the wall and put my fist through it. And I'm lying there, but I want to put my fist through it. Oh, Jesus, help me to love them. Bless my family. Will you stop it? Okay, Jesus. The door, because you were a sinner before you came in this door and met Jesus. There's nothing different about us except Jesus, the blood of Jesus. And that's what needs to come out of my mouth. That's what I need to be real about. Cheeks. He talks about cheeks. I mean, he covers everything on this woman's face. He's just looking in her face and saying, you're beautiful. He says, your cheeks, your temples and your cheeks. So the temples are behind the veil. Let me talk about the temples first. The temples behind the veil. What do you think the temples are? Right here is the temple. What's going on in here? Your thoughts. What's going on in your mind? What are your thoughts? Paul says, renew your mind. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you will know what is the acceptable and perfect will of God. You want to know what God's will is for your life? Get your mind renewed. Get into the Word. Get into the power of the Holy Spirit. Ask the Holy Spirit to reveal you and let Him show you. It's the only way. It's not going to happen in the flesh. It has to happen by the power of God's Word speaking to you and transforming you. And you'll walk in the will of God every single second. You won't even have to ask Him, oh, what do I do today, Lord? Because the Spirit's going to lead you. He's going to work it out. Even when you think you're not meant to be in this place, you turn up in this place, you go, wow, God had an appointment for me that I didn't this. That wasn't my plan today. That's because the Spirit's leading you. When you get into obedience, when you learn submission, when you die to yourself and just say, Lord, I'm going to go wherever I feel like there's nudging to go. It's such an exciting journey. Sometimes it looks ridiculous to the world. It might look ridiculous to your family. But be a woman who's transformed her thoughts with the renewing of her mind, Paul says. Think of things that are true, honest, just, pure, lovely, of good report, virtuous, and praiseworthy. Have good, fruitful thoughts. Take off negative thoughts. They'll kill you. There's a great teacher just now, neuroscientist, Dr. Carolyn Leaf. If you haven't heard her, I suggest listening to her. You will get so much information that she backs up biblically. She's a believer. And she uses her scientist mind. She's been in neuroscience for 30 years. And she says, you have got an opportunity when a negative thought comes into your mind to physically take a hold of it and throw it out before it starts to distort your brain. The mind affects the brain. The mind, if you don't know, the soul is made up of the mind, the emotions, and the will. It's a part of who you are. It's your flesh. It's different than your physical flesh. It's your immaterial flesh. In your flesh, you've got a physical flesh, you've got your brain, you've got your physical heart, you've got a skeleton, you've got a body, but there's more to you than the skeleton. That's just the shell holding your soul. When you get saved, when you receive Jesus as your Savior, the Spirit of God comes to live in you and bring your dead spirit alive. The Spirit died in the Garden of Eden. It disconnected us from God. The Spirit of man is in there so that you can communicate with God. But it died in the Garden of Eden. And Jesus said, you need to be born again. That's what born again is all about. It's like, I need to get born again in the Spirit. I got to have the Spirit of God in me to bring me alive. And now the Spirit of God in me starts renewing my mind, renewing my thoughts, renewing my emotions, healing me, making me into that new creation. I become a new creation, but I have to grow up in that new creation. Everybody with me so far? Okay, so the renewing of the mind, these thoughts, is so important, and it's not impossible to retrain your mind with the help of the Holy Spirit. Here's what happens if we don't do that. Dr. Karen Leith says, through new research, science research, that if you think negative thoughts, you will start to kill brain neurons. You're actually killing your brain. The more negativity you have, the more your brain is, and you can look on the diagrams, it's really phenomenal to see the impact of negative thoughts. Cast them out, the Bible says. Take hold of them and throw them out. Because they're not healthy for you. But if you develop good thoughts based on God's promises and His truth, your brain actually develops healthy neurons. Who knows, it probably makes you live longer too. So feed on what is good in your mind, in your thought life. Then he talks about the cheeks. Solomon talks about the cheeks. The cheeks, he says, are ruddy, glowing, behind the veil. You know, this look of healthiness. In spiritual terms, it's suggested that it's like spiritual vigor. You look alive. You're not a dead Christian. You're not just going to church on Sunday just to go to church on Sunday because that's what we do. But you're alive in your Christianity every moment of the day. Doesn't matter what day of the week it is. You're real. People can see that there is a real life of God going on inside of you. That's what God loves to see in you. And it's for His eyes only. He says it's behind the veil. The true character of our inner spiritual life is behind the veil for His eyes. They lose their true character and value once they're viewed by man. That's why I said, if you're doing your good works to please man, there's no value to the heart of God. He said, when you pray and fast, go into your closet and don't tell anybody about it. Don't go around telling around, I'm fasting for a week. I mean, of course, if you're having people praying with you and joining with you, that's fine. But, you know, Jesus was talking to the Pharisees, you make your face white, make yourself look miserable, I'm fasting, can I come out to play tonight? Because you know, it's like, that's what you do, isn't it? Woe is me. I'm sacrificing for Jesus. And He's going, no, you're not. I already paid the sacrifice. I don't need you doing this for me. You're doing this for you. You need to take that off. You need to get rid of that. I'm asking you to sit at my feet and listen to me. I'm not asking you to go out and look miserable to the world. I want to give you life. And He said, I want you to spend time with me because as you spend time with me, you'll get life. He goes on down in, I've turned to Matthew and I need to get back to Song of Songs, but he talks about the necklace around the neck is like the Tower of David, I'm sorry. Song of Songs, the neck, let's talk about the neck. The neck is about having a strong purpose. Talk last night, I said to you, let's take off shallow purpose and put on eternal purposes. Let's put on the serious things that God, not that we want to be serious people, but we want to be deep people, people of meaning, people that have a meaning to their lives, not like the shallowness of the world that's going on all around us. But it means that my neck cannot be stiff-necked like the Jews, you know, prideful, but have a neck that is willing to come under the yoke of Jesus, because Jesus says, my yoke is easy, my burden is light, and if you're yoked to me, I'm going to take the weight of it. But that means humility. That means your neck has got to bend. You've got to bow your neck and say, Jesus, it's your yoke, it's not mine. But if I stand up here and I'm going to make it all about my purpose and my way, I'm going to do it my way, that isn't pleasing to Jesus. It's not beautiful to him. What's attractive to him is a woman who is submitted under his yoke, who's willing to follow wherever he leads. Saul of Tarsus, he was a man, I read this, with a neck of iron sinew. It's a verse in Isaiah 48:4. People with necks with iron. Iron, he was stubborn, he was religious, he knew the word, and he was killing people who weren't adhering to the word. Well, what do we see happening today? People being killed in the name of God. Not our God. But for religion, people being slaughtered because of that. I didn't ask for that to happen. I haven't asked you to do that. I've already died for you. But submit to my love. The Tower of David reminds us of a man after God's own heart. A man and a woman who will do God's will. That's what God is looking for. Comes back to that submission. And then he talks about two breasts. And which is not often taught or spoken about. Because people find it really embarrassing. But actually it's the most beautiful book in the Bible if you understand the spiritual meaning behind it and what it's supposed to be teaching. And yes, it is based on a true love relationship, but it's in the Bible to give us spiritual insight. And so the breasts talk about affection. And there's two of them because the affections have to be in balance. Geneva shared with you how we often teach about needing the two wings of the butterfly to have spirit and truth. You need balance. If you've only ever been brought up with truth and you've never understood the fullness of the Spirit, you're going to go round in circles all the time. And it ends up in legalism and works and frazzled and guilt and condemnation. And Jesus does not want that yoke on your back. On the other hand, if all you have is spirit experience, I just need to feel Jesus, I just want to go to a meeting so I can experience him, and you leave the room and nothing's changed. And then you get depressed because you're not experiencing Jesus tomorrow morning. Because you've not got the truth of the fact that he never leaves you or forsakes you. He's with you whether you feel him or not. He's here. You know him. That's the balance of affections. The other balance of affections, I think, is not being over crazy about this particular ministry or that particular, you know, it's all about evangelism, or it's all about discipleship, or it's all about worship, or it's all about children, or it's all about this, or it's all about, it's about all of it. God's got it in the Bible for all of it. He's given us different gifts, but we need to embrace the part of the unity of the churches. We need all of it. We need each other. We need to grow in unity. I need to value the fact that there are some women in this room like Angie who have gifts that I have not got a clue. I am so thankful she was here last night when I was on my knees crying. She literally walked in the door just after I got up from crying on the floor going, Lord Jesus help us, I don't know what we're doing with the sound. And Angie appears and says, could I help you? Like the voice of the Holy Spirit. Oh, you see, if I hadn't been on my knees surrendering, she wouldn't have known I was in such a frazzle. She wouldn't have known because I'd have been walking around, oh, Tracy's got it all under control, we're good here. Oh, we don't need any help from you. Thank you very much, girls. You just get over there and pray for the meeting. We're fine. We got this, right, Tracy? But we didn't. We thought we did and we didn't. It was a total, like, it was going to be a disaster. Nobody at the front desk would help us. We couldn't get people around to help. Tracy's on the phone. We're trying to figure out. And in watch, Angie says, can I help you with that? Because she can see I'm frazzled. I don't know where she is. Where are you, Angie? Oh, she's over there. I'm like, yes, please. That's where humility gets you. Humility confesses, I can't do this on my own. God has called me to do certain things, but he's not called me to do all of it. But because I do this and you do that, doesn't mean that my thing is better than your thing or your thing is better than my thing. It means we're all needed together.
Amen.
It humbles me to say, oh my gosh, I couldn't be up here if Tracy hadn't done all the work to put this together with the team. And if Angie hadn't come up at that moment to help out, how the heck could we work as a body? We have to get over that. We have to have balanced affections and working in unity with one another. There's no self-exaltation in our beauty, for we become deeply conscious that it's the fruit of the death of Christ and the presence of the working of the Holy Spirit that brings about my beauty. That's where my beauty is. Those are the things that he sees in you that brings about the royal perfume. You might want to contemplate and think about those things in your life. But you may have some things that block you and stop you getting there. Turn with me to Mark 4. What are the things that stop us living that life of abundance in the Spirit? Jesus said, I have come to give you life abundantly. And Satan's come to try and steal it from you. But we want to leave here knowing that we have tasted what it's like, experienced another encounter today that helps us to live in the freedom of the Holy Spirit. Filled with Him, filled with His presence and His leading, His divine nature in me. Sheila Walsh says, the good news will never be good news until you know that God knows all of your bad news. I'll say that again. The good news will never be good news until you know that God knows all of your bad news. He knows it all. And He knows what you brought here today. Whether it's pain or something you're struggling with, the world, cares of the world. Jesus uses the parable of the sower. Sowing seed, and I was thinking about Lauren's garden behind Avalon Church as I was reading this, and thinking about the seeds that are planted to grow a garden. Mark chapter 4, Jesus explains a parable. It says, the sower sows the word, and these are the ones by the wayside. He's already told them that some seed goes on the wayside and it's wasted. And he's starting to give them revelation about what happens when he gets on stony ground. So he says, verse 15, and these are the ones by the wayside where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan comes immediately and takes away the word that was sown in their hearts. I pray that whatever God's word is that's going out today as we share with you and as He speaks to you, that it won't be thrown by the wayside, but that your hearts will receive it, soft ground. Verse 16, these likewise are the ones sown on stony ground, who when they hear the word, immediately receive it with gladness. And when they have no root in themselves, and they endure only for a little time. When the troubles come, and persecution comes, and tribulation arises, for the word's sake, immediately they stumble. You can receive the word in here. You can, you know, be thrilled, excited about how Jesus sees you. And then God tests us on the word. Right now we're at the top of the mountain. I hope we're at the top of the mountain. We're getting there. We're climbing up. The top of the mountain. We're getting revelations of Jesus and how He sees us. And that's like the disciples on the Mount of Transfiguration. They had a revelation of Jesus. But we're going to come down this mountain sometime tomorrow around lunchtime. And we're going to go back into normal life. And when the disciples came back down the mountain, they immediately encountered someone who was demon-possessed. And they didn't have to deal with it. And Jesus is going like, you have little faith. They had just seen Jesus. I mean, they'd just seen Him in all His glory. They had experienced the revelation of who He was in His glory, like nobody else on earth had seen. They come down the mountain, and they don't know how to use the power He's given them. So whatever happens in this room will be a testing time. We'll leave here, and there's going to be a test, and you have a choice. When the tribulations and the trials come and the doubts come in, or the situation that you go back home to has not got better, may have even got worse, when you dig into the roots and say, I'm not giving up. I never, never, never give up. I'm going to trust Him. I'm going to believe Him. I'm going to trust that His power is great. See, the weaker you are, the greater experience of God's power. We've got to get a hold of that. The reason we surrender is so that God's power can be exposed. If I continuously try to control my life, I will not experience the power of the Holy Spirit. He's real. Did you know that? We walk around as a church, have no idea about the power of God. We don't let Him. If we came as a church body, I'm not talking about any particular denomination, but the Western church today, if we came to the Red Sea, I heard it shared by an example of a woman who'd been converted from Islam to Christianity. This is what she said about the Western church. She said, if you came to the Red Sea, you would have a meeting to strategize how to build a bridge to get over it. And then you would send out letters to raise money for this great project that God's given you to do, and then you would start recruiting workers to come who are Christians that will work on the bridge. You get the bridge built, you're very pleased, you're sending out reports as the progress is made. The bridge gets built, you make it to the other side, and you send a letter, praise God! He's done a wonderful work, we made it to the other side, and God's going, it was nothing to do with me. There's no glory in that for me, I didn't build it. I'm the God of miracles. I do things with power, we've got to see God. If you're in a desperate place, praise God for it. Praise God, I've been desperate this week, desperate. God, I couldn't hear anything. I thought I had a great message put together when I was back at the beach a month ago. I came back, oh, wow, great stuff, Lord. Thank you, got this message on the garden, ready for the bride, got it all stitched up, and it fell apart completely. It was like all just went up in the air in papers, and I'm like trying to pull it down, bring it down, or help me get something back, and it's all over. None of it's making any sense to me. None of it. And I got on my knees and I said, not by might nor by power, but by your spirit, God, do a miracle. Show up for these women, because this is not about me, Lord. You called me to this. I was invited to do this. I didn't ask to do this. I was asked to come in, and I have to trust that you're asking me, Lord. You want me to be there because you want to do something powerful. I'm expecting God to do something powerful today in your life. I'm asking Him for it. We have begged for Him for this. We need revival in our churches. We need help in Orlando, Florida. We need it in our United States. We're in trouble. We're heading into trouble. Our ship is like a massive cruise ship, all having pleasure, and we're about to hit the Titanic iceberg. We need to get the power of God, or we are done. We're done. Wake up, church. We're the bride. But it's not my power. It's His power. It's His power. It's His power. He is able to do far exceedingly above all you can ask, think, or even imagine, according to what? The power that is in you. The power that is in you. His power is in you. The power of the Holy Spirit is in you. And in me, release the power now. Die. Die. Give Him a chance. Let Him show up what He can do in your life. You can turn it around. He's done it for me. And He's going to do it again. And again, because the enemy comes back to fight, and I go, bring it on, Satan. I know how you get defeated, and I'm going to walk through this. I have been put on planes when I'm raging fear, and had to fly through those storms to get to women at the other side of the world. I did have to face my fears in order to follow Jesus, but He gave me the power when I was the most weak. Weakness is great. The least of us are the greatest in the kingdom of God. God, are you going to release your power on us in Avalon? And in East Orlando, through these women, will you do it, Lord Jesus? You know how you'll do it? Through every heart, humbling ourselves and confessing that I need Him. We cannot do it on our own. I have to confess, Lord, I don't know what she's talking about. I need this. God, how do I get it? Be open. Confess. Confess. Look what He goes on to say in this chapter 17. They have no root in themselves. No root in themselves. There's no root. There's no root of David in your life. And the tribulation comes and steals the word of God. And then there's the thorns. Those are the ones that sow among thorns. They're the ones who hear the word and listen to this. The cares of the world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the desires for other things entering in, and they choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. That is the church of the West. That is the church of the West. The cares of this world. We're so consumed with this stinking, dying, dirty old world. We're so consumed with the desires for this world, the things of this world, the riches of this world. It means nothing to God's kingdom. While others are dying and perishing and going to hell, we are consumed with our riches. Jesus says, follow me and give up everything. And that might not mean you having to go to Africa. He's talking about right here at home. Just give me your whole heart. Give me it all, ladies, and watch what I will do. Imagine what God could do with 80 women who totally surrender and say, Lord, I'm a mess. Help me. I've got terrible things going on at home, but I'm going to trust you to bring me through this. And we won't all get to be able to stand up here and shout like I'm doing. But my goodness, you can be a powerhouse right where you are. You know where I learned the power? Not up here. Oh my gosh. No, it's in the hidden place of the tears and the pain. And I watched God bring me through and give me victory in little things and big things. And things that I could fill books with and there's not enough space. But God is powerful. And we need to expect that of him. And the only way it comes is when we stop desiring the things of this world and the things of the flesh. We've got to get serious about him. It's time to be serious about the power of God and wanting what he wants in this world before he comes back. I met a girl in India. She'd just been saved. She was from a Hindu background. And somebody brought her to my room. And I didn't want to see her because I'd just got off a plane after 40 hours of travel. And they brought me, so I was staying at a YMCA in India, and this young girl, the housekeeper brought me, she said, please, this woman just met Jesus and her sister, two of them. And they came from a faction of India, Hinduism, which is really one of the strongest. And there's millions of people in there, and I say millions because there's billions in India, but there were millions of their sect who have never heard about Jesus. And she started asking me, she said, I've changed my name to Ruth from her Indian name. And she said, can you tell me about Ruth? Because I know she's in the Bible. She's only been 1 month saved. And so I start telling about the love story of Boaz and Ruth and how that's Jesus and us. This girl's looking at me. And at some point I said, you know, it's only Jesus that will give us that eternal life, and that relationship with him is like Boaz. He loves us that much. And she's looking at me. She said, there's no other way to have eternal life. And she starts crying. She looks at me. She said, why did nobody tell us? Why did nobody tell us? She said, there's thousands of my people don't know this. They don't know it. Nobody's telling them. And I was sitting there going, oh my God, forgive us. Please forgive us, Lord, because we've got thousands of Christians sitting back in America that are stuffed full of the Word of God and don't know how to use it. We've sat through every Beth Moore Bible study. Praise God for Beth Moore. We've sat through Kay Arthur. We've sat through Joyce Meyer and every other preacher and Charles Stanley and anybody new that comes out, and we worship great worship. And what are we doing with the resources God has given us to reach our world, America? Why are we in such a mess today? Not because the world's in a problem, because we're in a problem. The church has lost its power because we've lost the truth, because the cares of the world have come in and they've taken what Jesus gave us that was a treasure, and his lamp is going out. His lamp's going out. And he's crying out to us to say, I want to come and light your lamp. I want my light to shine in the darkness. And if he needs to take us through tribulation to get us there, he's going to do it as a country. The ones that are shining the brightest in the world today are people who are living under persecution. God help them. I don't ever want to go that path. But it will come because God loves us so much. And he loves people so much. And he's going to use you. He's going to allow you to go through things so that you know him. You know his sufferings. You really know him. You're not just living a life of Bible teaching. You're living a life of Jesus. You know him.
Amen.
Verse 20. But these are the ones sown on good ground. Those who hear the word, they accept it and they bear fruit. Some 30-fold, some 60-fold, and some 100-fold. He might not call you to huge ministry. What's that anyway? It's just more responsibility. It's harder. It doesn't get easier. You don't get more benefits in ministry just because you get the bigger job. He says, unto whom much is given, much is required. Yeah. Don't go begging for that. Don't go looking for it. Let him give it to you. He's the only one that can exalt you. It was because Jesus was prepared to die and lose his reputation, lose his identity with his father, lose everything. His father forsaking him. He was prepared to go through that. Because he loved us and because the Father had sent him to purchase a bride. And God was so pleased with him. It says in Philippians chapter 2, therefore, I love that word, therefore, Liz, God raised you up out of the dead because you were prepared to die. Therefore, Lorraine, God raises you up to live for him. He raises you up. Because what? Because therefore, he raised Jesus from the dead and he gave him a name that is above all names.
Hallelujah.
King of kings and Lord of lords. That every knee will bow at the name of Jesus. The things in heaven, the things in earth, and the things under the earth. Because he is King of kings and Lord of lords.
Hallelujah.
Blessed be his name alone. Death Babylon, in Babel, they tried to build a name for themselves. They wanted to make a name in Genesis chapter 11. And God said, oh no, let us go down and destroy that one straight away. If they'd only waited, in Genesis chapter 12, God raises up a man called Abraham and he says, I will make your name great. I will make you a great nation. I will. Not you. He found a man who followed him in faith. He had a man who was ready to humble himself. He didn't have to build his own kingdom. You don't have to build your own kingdom, your own platform, your own name, your own identity. God will give you his name. He will give you the seed to bring forth if you will die to yourself. What are the things that are stopping you? Song of Songs, chapter 5. One of the things we said yesterday that can stop us is complacency. A complacent spirit. Here's this beautiful Shulamite, dark but lovely, which is represented by our sin that we've been made righteous in his eyes. And he's talking to her about this garden. He's telling her how beautiful she is. She's had all this romancing. And then in verse 2 of chapter 5, I sleep, but my heart is awake. The voice of my beloved, he knocks, saying, open for thee, my sister, my love, my dove, my perfect woman. My head is covered with dew, my locks with the drops of the night. And she says, I have taken off my robe. How can I put it on again? I've washed my feet. How can I defile them again? We've got complacent. We've accepted the love of Jesus as salvation of our sins. But when he comes calling and saying, you know what, I want you to take some time out from doing ministry. I want you to just sit with me for a while. I want you to come. You need me. I want to speak to you. I want to deal with some things in your heart. I know what you've been through, and I want you to get some healing. And we run from that. We just keep doing. Or we've become so complacent in just going to church for years. Same old family friends at church. Same thing, we do our life groups and we do our routines. Go and help serve in other areas and kitchens and children, whatever it is, and we think we're good. And we've just got into a complacent letter. There is nothing of spiritual vitality in us. Kind of taking off the rope. I got my salvation, got my righteousness. I'm good. Sit back and watch TV for a while. And Jesus is saying, I want to spend some time with you. And he won't force his way into your heart. It says that his hand was on the doorknob, dripping. He was waiting for her to open, and she didn't get up fast enough, and he left. He's knocking on some hearts today. He's saying, I want to have more conversation with you. I love you so much. Could you just lay some things aside for a while? Let me heal you. Let me speak to you. Let me tell you what my plans are. Wouldn't that be interesting? Oh my goodness, let's just spend some time with Jesus and hear what he wants. Instead of me thinking I know what I want and what I think he thinks of, he wants. How about we just go and listen to him? Am I on track? Am I where you want me to be? I mean, all this stuff I'm doing, is this what you want me to do? And if he says, yeah, great, you can do it in his strength. He will give you the strength to do what he calls you to do. If you have a full schedule and God's giving you that full schedule, that's the season. He's going to give you the strength, and you'll have to do it in his strength. But if you take on more than you can, you're going to get that bitter heart, angry, hurt, wounded, offended, obnoxious, all that stuff. Or maybe you've been through some grief and pain, and he's just saying, let's just have a conversation about that. I want to heal you. Sometimes we can be ignorant about the things that we fall into that cause us trouble. That's where I ended up. Yesterday I talked to you about seduction, and a lot of it was ignorance. I didn't know that could happen to somebody who's born again and loved Jesus. But I can tell you this, for those of you in the room who say, well, everything you're talking about, I'm right there, I love Jesus so much. I'm going to say to you, okay, get your armor on and get your guard up. Because he doesn't just come after us when we're in sin. Actually, most believers, he comes when you're not sinning. Because I don't think most of us willfully fall into sin when you're following Jesus. But he, that lion, comes around and he knows where your weaknesses are. Ben Moore talks about how the roaring lion wakes up the bear in you that you thought was dead. The bear is your weakness. What is your weakness? You might not even know what it is. The Lord did, said to you, it took years for me to figure out, this is actually a weakness. I keep falling down the same path. I need to ask the Lord to deal with this. I can confess it. I can repent of it. But I need to get totally healed and delivered on it. Because the enemy will use it. Your greatest strength can also be your greatest weakness. The very thing that God has called you to do, to minister. Satan knows there's something going on with your destiny. He knew it for Peter. He knew it for Job. He kept tripping Peter up. Because he knew his destiny. And Satan couldn't stop Peter's destiny. But he went to Jesus and he said, Peter, and the Lord says, he tells us in Luke chapter 22, he says, Peter, Satan has required that I test you. I think the original translation is like that you're really, I'll find the words later for you, but it's like he's asked to try you. But Jesus says, but I have prayed for you that you would not fail, that your faith would not fail. Jesus is praying for you. If you're in a trial, it's not because you've sinned. It may not be because of something going on, but it's because we are going to be tried and tested because the enemy hates you with a passion. As soon as you step into the kingdom and start stepping up, oh man, he hates that. He does not want you to open your voice for Jesus. And so he's going to come to Jesus and he's going to start accusing you because he's the accuser of the brethren. Have you seen her doing this? Have you seen her doing that? Oh, just like Job. Oh, she looks like she's praising you now, but when I push this button, you watch how fast she's going to fall. And sometimes that happens. We fall, and he'll do it again because he knows where he's going to get you. He knows where to bring you down. He knows what sends you into an emotional spiral every single time. That's where addictions come from. That's why we end up in counselors again, and we're on the same mountain. Does anybody understand what I'm talking about? That mountain that just keeps tripping you up. I want to follow Jesus, and it just keeps going wrong. Well, there's hope. First of all, we have to recognize the problem. We have to ask the Lord to show us the root. We have to know where the root is coming from. Sometimes we can have more spiritual passion than we actually have biblical truth. That was another issue I fell into. Passionate for Jesus, love Jesus, but I didn't know how to marry the word up. I was like, you know, it's all about grace. Take a piece here, take a piece there. What I don't do right, God covers in his grace, which is true. But if you've got more passion than spiritual truth, you're going to keep going around the circle again. You need to get the balance of God's word in you and live it. God said to Joshua, meditate on my word day and night so that everything you do, you will prosper in it. We have to follow that word of a God with radical obedience. My life changed when I understood that. It's about radical. I'm talking radical obedience. That means not deviating to the right or the left. That's when he said to Joshua, don't look to the right or the left. That means that you're going to be on your own sometimes. Other people aren't going to get it. But if you're following Jesus, you're going to be radical in obedience because you will prosper in that. If you turn to your manuals, to your folder rather, you're going to find a carrot diagram in there. We have a carrot diagram. I've lost my folder. I don't know where it went, but you do have it. Okay, here it is. It says transformation, identifying roots of inner sickness, areas that need healing. What is it that stops us living in power and stops us living in freedom are often things that are rooted in things that have happened to us or that we have done and feel ashamed of and don't know how to get free of, or we've experienced the trials of life which have nothing to do with what we've done ourselves, and we're blaming ourselves anyway. In Proverbs chapter 18, verse 14, it says, "The spirit of a man will sustain him in sickness, but who can bear a broken spirit?" If your spirit is broken because of circumstances, it's hard to bear. God knows that. In Proverbs also says, "When there's no hope, that you'll perish." And when you've been through pain, those of you who've gone through great pain for different reasons, you know it's just like, it's so hard. You just lose your life. You think you're never going to breathe again. Some of you are walking through relatives who have cancer. I mean, perhaps you do. Yeah, how do I get through that? Well, you know what? I think I would suggest to you that one of the ways you get through it is you get along with the Lord and you say, "Lord, what's going on inside of me that's causing me to have fear, anxiety, anger, unforgiveness, shame, bitterness? What is it that's at the root?" Ask him to show you the root, because see, when we see the root, when we get to the root of it, we can face it and he can deal with it. That's freedom. Not covering it over and trying to be brave and smacking a scripture on your face and thinking that's going to make the difference. We've got to get inside and dig out the bad roots. That's what gardeners do. The plant isn't bearing fruit in some aspect of your life, God's going to come along and say, "That needs to come out, because that's been rotting from the beginning." Or maybe it's a bad seed that got in there, bad thinking, unbelief in God. You can say, "Well, I'm a believer, Liz." Well, yeah, you are, you may be, but what does believing mean? Believing in a God who created me and who says that all of his plans for me are good and he has a purpose for me. And that he will work all things together for good. And you can say, and I know because I've been there, I can believe him in all this, like 75% of my life, I'm good. I can go and share the gospel, I can teach women the word of God, I can do all this. But this area over here, which for me was flying, was like such a huge fear. And in order to go and share the gospel and teach other women, I had to get through the fear. And I went to speak to a lady, somebody like Geneva, to ask her to help me, that I knew I was in trouble. And God called me to Vietnam and I was like 45 hours on a plane, but I can't do this. It was literally making me feel sick. My stomach was in knots thinking about it. It was making me ill. I had to go to the doctor for tablets for my stomach then. And I went to see this woman. I said, "I need help. Something's going on." And the first thing she said to me was, "Have you confessed unbelief?" And I looked at her and I wanted to say in my, you know, shock and self-righteousness, "I've got huge faith, actually." Because I travel the world to tell people about God, and I love him, and I've seen him do great and mighty things. And, you know, like all that was going through my head, those thoughts. And I'm like, out of my mouth, I'm going, "No. No, I don't think so. I haven't done that one." She said, "Well, what's the opposite of fear?" Is the opposite of fear?
Courage,
trust, faith. God says in 1 John chapter 4, verse 18, perfect love casts out fear. Perfect love casts out fear. So, I don't know where my pens are here. One of the things that I mentioned yesterday, I'm going to write this up for you to help us on this journey. Oh, maybe if I can't get back there, you could write this up there for me, Tracy. Can you just put those four words down? Know, love, trust, freedom. Perfect love casts out fear. If I have a fear, I need to come to the Lord and say, "I'm clearly not understanding your perfect love, Lord." And that's what I had to do. I had to confess it in the first place, because it's a sin. If I'm not trusting in God, it's a sin, isn't it? I'm questioning his ability to keep me through this situation. I'm questioning his ability to deliver me or to give me strength to walk through it. And the fear mounts, and suddenly I'm taking control But actually all I've done is give control to the enemy. Now I'm back in his camp. Now I'm under bondage. I'm a child of God, but I'm living as a slave. Because I'm afraid. And I'm telling you, it's real fear when you're on a flight and you're being thrown around at 37 miles, 37,000 feet in the air, and you have fear of flying. And I was just sick with the thought of it. I did not want to go. So Satan was making everything he could do to stop me going to the other side of the world to help women get freedom. Guess what? I had to get free first. And it's a bit like being an alcoholic, because I cannot say I am completely delivered. I will not stand up in a room and say, I'm totally delivered. You know what? God has given me the ability to get on planes and get on and fly through and trust him, and it's been beautiful. But I dare not get on a plane without having spent time in worship and putting him on the throne and getting my mind refocused into he's God, he's made me, his plans for me are good. Whatever happens, I'm with Jesus, it's okay. But the root of that fear, I had to find out. She said, what's the root? She took me to my worst trauma. We talked about it, and as we're talking about the trauma, I remembered an incident where something happened where a plane nosedived out of the air, and it was just like this, and we were, it was a plane to South America, and I was the loudest screamer on the plane, screaming, Jesus! At the top of my voice. I was so scared, and I grabbed the guy next to me who worked for me. I'd drawn blood out of his arm. I was so scared. That's how scared I was. But that cry for Jesus, that plane, suddenly righted itself.
Hallelujah.
And see, nobody on that plane told us what happened. The air staff, the crew, of course, they're all South Americans and all Catholics, and they're like, Jesus,
Father, Son, Holy Spirit.
But I'm like, Jesus, help us. And so the plane righted itself. But the captain never came on and told us what had happened. So I had this inbuilt mistrust of pilots. Every time I got on a plane, he's not going to tell us. This thing's going to fall out of the sky. Nobody's going to tell us. So there were multiple things going on inside. I'm always waiting for that turbulent thing. It's going to happen again. It's going to happen again. Satan used that to just build up this huge fear, so that when years later, because when that incident happened, I was in the tourism industry. I wasn't even doing missions as such then. Oh, gosh, did that. See, that was a seed that went in there. Because Satan knew down the line I would be doing a lot more flying for Jesus, and he needed to stop that with everything he had in him. He pulled out everything to do it. And I had to confess that and see the plan, understand his battle plan, and say, okay, I'm going to confess it, Lord. You're right. I have not trusted you. Show me your love. Help me to trust you. Show me more of your love. That's why intimacy is so important, because the more intimate you become with Jesus, to know him means you're going to love him, which means you're going to trust him, which is freedom, because then you can go anywhere and say, I'm the Lord's hands. I don't care. I don't care. And another route was the process of dying. I was happy to go and be with Jesus. I just didn't want to die on a plane. I had to release that and say, okay, this is where God chooses. That's okay. That's okay. Oh, that took me a while to work through that one. But that's how we get freedom. It's confessing it. It's repenting of the behavior. Even when it's not something that's been done to you. And I'm talking about those of you who have been victimized, who have been abused, who have been hurt and wounded. And you're going, this doesn't apply to me, Liz, because I haven't sinned in that way. But the sin comes in when it breeds unbelief in God, mistrust and anger towards others, and that leads to unforgiveness. And we're back into bondage again. And we have to keep a healthy heart. We have to always be keeping our heart saying, okay, Lord, I forgive. I don't understand. But when you forgive, you are not letting that person off the hook in terms of them coming to some kind of justice. What you're saying is, Lord, I can't judge somebody else because I'm a sinner too. And he loves both of you. And you take that person and you put them in God's hands, because God says in Romans chapter 12, revenge is mine. Let me deal with it. Release yourself from the burden of that person. Otherwise, you're going to be having a soul tie to that person for the rest of your life. You know what you need to do? When I had a season going through horrible heart stuff, and it was just so heavy, and I just could not get rid of it, and it was anger, and it was just, it kept on going on. You know what it's like when somebody's really hurting you continuously. And I was praying about it at the top of a mountain in North Carolina, and the Lord showed me two balloons in my heart, red balloons. And he said, and they represented me and this other person. He said, I want you to unhook the balloons. Because that soul tie, so soul ties, an intimate connection that literally happens, like Saul and Jonathan and David were knit together. Husbands and wives get knit together, God's knitting you together as one. When divorce happens and you're pulled apart, there's excruciating agony. And if you've had sex before marriage with somebody, it doesn't matter whether you were married or not, you form a soul tie. And when you break away, that's fine for women. It is crazy for us to have sex outside of marriage. When you're sleeping with so many men, you're building up a soul tie with every single person you sleep with. And that just is, you're taking a part of them on you. And that has to be broken off if you want freedom. You've got to get rid of all that stuff. Even if you're married and happy now, cut it off, break it, release it to the Lord. Give yourself a break. I know because I had to do it. And that day was a different situation. It wasn't a sexual situation. It was a situation, it's still a relationship, very painful, rejection, and ongoing pain. And I had to bring this, and he said, release those balloons and let them come into the spirit realm. Let me deal with it. I sat there, metaphorically, I said, Lord, okay. Because when you hear the voice of God, you do it. You know, you don't question it. You go like, okay. You know, and that's what I beg him to speak to you about. I beg that for myself. Lord, convict me if I'm doing something wrong. If there's something you need to show me, that inner voice, tell me, because I know when I hear it, I know he's convicting me. And this is not the voice of accusation. That's not the accuser's voice. It's when he's going, I want you to be free of this. I want you to be free. Unhook the balloon and trust me. I've got it. I want you to rise up to live in spiritual freedom and fly with both wings. And you can do this. Trust me. I've got the other person. Leave them to me. Leave it behind. Daily. Take up your cross daily, Jesus said. Because some of you are going to say, Liz, you do not know the situation. I had to live with it. Jesus said daily. How many times you forgive? 77 times 7. Over and over and over. That's hard. But Jesus is doing it every single day. One of the pains that I experienced going through having to forgive somebody over and over and over, at some point, it was around the time of the balloons, I was like, I can't take it anymore. I cannot take this attack on my heart. And the Lord said, now you know how I feel every minute, every second, every day, of every week, of every month, of every year, for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. People are rejecting Jesus every single minute of the day. We do it ourselves sometimes. It hurts his heart, but he continues to offer you forgiveness. And so he expects it for us to do it for others, because that's the path of the cross. That's the heart of God. The heart of God is to love and forgive. Who has wounded you in your life? I want you to look at that carrot. Many of the symptoms of physical sickness are rooted in hurts that come from wounding or abuse on the spirit and soul. Medicine alone cannot heal these wounds. Just as it takes time for the physical body to heal, so it is with the healing of the spirit and soul. When we receive God's spirit in us, reborn, that's only the beginning of God's healing process in our life, as he brings us through the journey to health and wholeness. Here's a garden example of a carrot. When a carrot's in the ground, you don't see what's under the ground. You only see what's above the ground. And when we look at our spiritual lives, often, or other people's lives, emotional lives, often all we see is the evidence of a physical behavior or a physical attitude that we often want to treat in the West with medication, or in the East with meditation. When neither of them work, yoga isn't going to fix it, even if they give it a Christian name. Amen. It's something you have to get to the root of. If there's behaviors, you'll see this in others. What is a visible sign of a sickness underneath me? Continual physical and emotional sickness. That was my stomach issue because of the fear of flying. Other signs can be people who have anger, pride, bitterness, unforgiveness, resentment, and you see it in their life. Victim mentality. I speak to a lot of women who are mothers who are that victim mentality. I think there's a generation that went through a lot of difficult things. My mother has shared this with me. Nobody talked to them about inner healing, about dealing with it. They just had to stuff it and get on with it. But if you stuff that long enough, by the time you get to old age, you just become so shriveled up inside your heart, expecting everybody to be there for you and wanting, and it just manifests itself in ways that is so draining on other people. Because you've never had the healing and the freedom in the beginning. Self-pity is a classic sign. Constantly focused on me. But what's the root of that? Self-hatred. You hate yourself? Why? Depression. Suicidal thoughts. You know, we all go through depression, some more than others. And I praise God when I read about Spurgeon and Moody, and they both had terrible times of depression. But out of it, God delivered them. But when it's suicidal depression, you need to talk to somebody. And I wish there were more of us available, making ourselves available, because it's huge right now. There's so many young people that are having suicidal thoughts, and adults. Suicidal thoughts. People are so depressed. There's so much hopelessness. How can we be ministers to them? We've got to understand this, the path to inner healing. He says, the other thing is abnormal fears, which we've talked about. Behavior, sinful behavior consistently. Addictions. Are all signs, and there's more, you could go on, divorce. I mean, there's just, you could come up with a list. You can do this on your own this afternoon, or maybe you want to get together with your groups after lunch if it's raining. I don't know what the weather's like outside, but we're going to take a moment here to talk about what are the roots of those behaviors, the things that are above the ground. You might think about somebody else, but I want you to think about yourself and not leave yourself out of this. But you might start thinking, yeah, this person's always angry. What's that about? So instead of judging them, you can start praying for them. Lord, and here's the prayer. Write this one down and take it to the bank because you'll take it with you everywhere you go. Shine your light and truth and let them lead me to your holy hill. Psalm 43, verse 3. Shine your light and truth and let them lead me to your holy hill. You might have heard in the Old Testament about the Thummim and the Cummim, that they would wear on the breastplate, the priests would wear it, and those would light up. At times that they needed wisdom, it was like that was the needing the perception of God, the light of God. And we need the light of God to give us wisdom, to show us the things that are hidden. In somebody else's life, if you're praying with them, or in your own life. I have never prayed this prayer and God didn't show me the truth through his light. He puts the light, he is light in you. You pray that into any situation where there's confusion, and you can't see, like, what is this mess? Start praying, Lord, shine your light in your truth. Shine your light in your truth. Oh my goodness, he's going to show you. Ask him and he will show you. So you start by praying that. And then just going down this list, it says here, what are some of the roots that can be underneath the ground of our hearts? Is it sin? Am I living in a sinful area of my life? Do I have ancestral ties? Are there patterns of behavior in my family? Addictions would be a typical one, but there may be other things that have been passed down in a family. Bondages, things that stop me living in freedom. Fear of man, behaviors. We talked about some of those things that just stop you living as a full, free Christian. Things that tie me up. My own self-righteousness can be a bondage. Lies. What lies have you been believing about yourself or about somebody else? And damaged soul or spirit. We're going to take it a bit deeper now. What does it mean to have a damaged soul or spirit? Here are some of the causes. Your soul, remember, is your mind and your emotions. Your spirit is that part that communicates with God. And both of them can be damaged. When we've been, whether we're saved or not, we get hurt all the time. But some of us have been hurt in the past and never had that healing for a damaged heart and mind. It could be an ungodly spirit has entered. You may have touched some occult practices. You may have had some behaviors that you have not got freedom from them. And you need to confess those and get those out of your life and have some deliverance. Lack of nurture that God intended. Children who have not experienced the nurture of a parent can have very broken emotions as they grow into adults. And that may have been you. Rejection, it happens to all of us. It's the biggest single cause, I think, of behaviors of insecurity. The fear of rejection. Because we were rejected in the Garden of Eden by God, basically. I mean, we rejected him, and then he rejected, he put us outside. It's like in our nature. We need to be loved. He made us to be loved. We're hungry for love. And when people reject us, it kills us. And so we put up this barrier, like, I'm okay. And we keep ourselves distanced from people, and we don't want intimacy because we're afraid of being hurt again. Mm-hmm. Does anybody know that? What we're talking? All of us. I bet everybody, one of us in this room, have that fear of rejection deep down. And God says, you're accepted in the beloved. Ephesians chapter 1, 6. He accepts you. There is a way out of that rejection. Pronouncement of curses. Words spoken over you which are negative, things that as you're a child or maybe in a job. Betty talked about, she started sharing her testimony and somebody came along and said, you might not want to share that. That was a curse over her. It shut her down for years. She didn't have freedom and she was in bondage. That's a bondage right there. Bondage to somebody's words. Killed the life in Betty for years. 20 or more years. How we speak over people is important. And somebody may have spoken negative words over you. And right now, I want to take those off you in the name of Jesus because they're not true. They're the lies of the enemy. God does not speak to you the way that negative person spoke to you. So no, it wasn't from him. Human expectations, living up to a mother or a father or a boss or a church or another woman, you know, competing, trying to stay up with what's happening. It's going to drive you crazy, but it'll keep you in bondage. We need to look at what Jesus' expectations is of us. Abuse, physical, emotional, sexual, spiritual, educational. Some countries, girls have never been educated, children have never been educated because they're put into hard labor. That is abuse. Because as they go older, they end up in poverty, they end up in sex prostitution, labor prostitution. I mean, all sorts of things. It's an abuse to not be educated these days. Because it leads to something so much worse. But I'm so sorry for those of you who have gone through any kind of abuse. It's horrible and God never intended it for you. And he wants to heal you of that. He loves you. He never intended that for your life. And there is healing, by the way. For those of you who have not experienced it, there is healing. And please talk to one of us today for any of these things. In particular, as I said, Geneva's available for that. Accident and trauma. My trauma on the plane was a route that became a big fear. It might cause you to not want to go back into a car again. It might not make you want to not fly. What is the trauma that caused you to stop doing something in your life that's put you back into bondage? Created fear. Loss. Losing somebody traumatically, or just losing somebody close to you, any kind of loss, terrible pain. God wants to heal that so that it doesn't become something that is stagnant or is a burden that you carry around. He wants to take it from you and heal you and use it. Bereavement. Loss, by the way, can also mean loss of a job. You know, loss of a relationship is not just always death. You can lose a job and grieve over it. You can lose a relationship and grieve over it. And it's okay to confess that and say, that really hurt. The problems come in all of this when we don't confess it and call it what it is. And that doesn't mean that you've got to go and confess everything to everybody. I'm talking about you get with the Lord and you allow him to shine light and truth and you admit what it is. Why do you maybe go through a sin pattern? Is it because you need to be affirmed and accepted and made secure by what other people say or by what you do? Oh gosh, how many of us fall into that pattern? Trying to find our security and our identity in what we do. Ask God to show you the root. Why is that there? For any of this, I want to just give you a minute of silence. I know it's been a long morning, but we've got 10 minutes here at the end where I want you to take a piece of paper, the next page in your notebook if you like, and just spend a moment praying. And just ask, but go through that list. I'm going to ask the Holy Spirit to reveal to us anything that He wants you to confess to Him that's keeping you in bondage or that is painful. You heard Cindy, her marriage kept her in pain for a long time. Just because we're believers, even doing ministry, even mature believers, we all get hurt all the time. So let's bow our head, let me pray for you this last 10 minutes. Lord Jesus.